So thank you, Kanika. Thanks a lot for allowing me to speak here. Yes. So I'm going to talk about the mathematics underlying a chemical reaction. What we are going to do is, when you are going to think chemistry, you will think of a reaction, right? Most of you. So we do a reaction first. Then we'll talk about the mathematics underlying it. And we do a fairly dramatic reaction. Okay, so these balloons contain hydrogen, right? We'll do the reaction and then we'll start talking about, you know, how to look at it mathematically and all that. Okay, here we go.
Oh. Look at the projectors.
Oh yeah. It's a very dramatic chemical reaction, right? And also it happened very quickly. But this is just one such very dramatic reaction. We have reactions happening, you know, all the time. And Chaitanya has, you know, actually referred to some reactions. He's also talked about another process which I am going to actually refer to, that bottle that we had. What we want to look at is, how do we understand this reaction? Okay, any reaction for that matter, but maybe this one. And this is quite simple, but what we'll actually look at is trying to understand something even simpler than this, because this already gets complicated. But the goal is to understand why this reaction happened. Now, let's look at something which involves these three components. Okay, but it's not quite the reaction that you saw. Okay, so I'm just going to show you a video of that, which we filmed yesterday using the media center's help. Now see, that was too fast. Now you'll see the same thing in slow motion again. So what you're seeing is that the reverse reaction is happening. And you believe me, you could film this yesterday. How many of you believe that? How do you think we made this? We just ran the film backwards, right? So obviously, even though the components are the same in both of these reactions, the reaction just went one way. It doesn't go the other way. Now, there's something about nature which decides that with these three components, the reaction has to go spontaneously in one direction. So the question we ask is, what is the reason for that spontaneity? Why do reactions happen the way they do? So in other words, we can ask the question, what is the driving force for this reaction? Or more generally, what is the driving force for any spontaneous change? And you'll see remarkably, it's actually the same driving force, which is, you know, symmetric across all sorts of spontaneous processes. And it's a very mathematical kind of thing. It's surprisingly, to understand chemistry, or to understand a reaction which is at the heart of chemistry, you actually need mathematics, which is at the heart of a reaction. Okay, so that's what I want to illustrate. And this spontaneous change is also what happened when Chaitanya put that ink drop in that bottle of water. Right? It was a change. There was nothing really apparently driving that reaction. Right? It just happened. Here also, apparently there's nothing, you're not pushing it by doing work on it, you're not kind of, you know, heating it, it's just happening on its own. And the other direction is not happening. So why is this? What would you start thinking? You know, when you start thinking of something happening spontaneously, you probably tend to think about something to do with its energy. Right? And you might wonder, okay, the energy is decreasing or increasing or something like that. But if you look at it carefully and try to analyze the whole thing, you'll actually see that in any process, energy will be conserved. Okay, a change will happen. The total energy before and after remains exactly the same. So then what is it about energy that's, what has changed about energy which is now making this happen one way and not go the other way? And the answer to that, I get the answer right away. I wish I had more time to allow you to ponder over this. But here is the answer. That even though the energy is the same before and after, the energy before was in some sense more clumped up. It was more concentrated. And the energy after is more spread out. Okay, in a very qualitative sense, that is what is happening. The nature just is wanting to spread out. It's the same energy, which is before and after, it's just distributed in a different way. If you want to say it's a little more quantitatively, you can invoke this idea of microstates, okay, which is the only one concept which I'm going to kind of define for you and hopefully explain to you a little bit. But the same idea that energy is more clumped up in A and more spread out in B, you can see in a little more quantitative manner by saying that the energy is distributed in more number of microstates in B as compared to A. Okay, and this is really the content of the second law of thermodynamics, which is telling you why change happens, why transformation happens. Okay, so let's examine what microstates means, because that can really give us a idea about why, you know, why there are more microstates in B and less in A, and therefore you know why it moves in one direction. So what is a microstate? That's the concept I really want you to understand. I mean, this is more for students, and I'm sure a lot of faculty probably already know this. So the first idea that you need to have in mind is that energy is context. Okay, to understand, to define a microstate, this is kind of a given assumption that you have to make, that energy is context. The second thing is that this total energy, which is a total property of the system, that's a macroscopic property, can be distributed in different ways in these microstates. And I'll show you some examples, some concrete examples, where you'll see that the energy, the total energy is the same, but the way of distributing it is different. And each such way of distributing energy is what we call a microstate. Okay? So let's look at this concretely so that it becomes absolutely clear that what is this each way of distributing energy, what is total energy and all of that, okay? With a very simple example. The example I'm going to take is, let's say you have just one quantum of energy. See, I'm invoking the idea that energy is context. So let's say you have just one quantum of energy and there are four particles in which you want to distribute it. Okay? And the particles are distinguishable. That's important. These are classical particles, distinguishable. Each of them have different colors. I'm just, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 as it's becoming, you know, higher frequency colors are more on the more higher numbers. Okay? So this is what you could do with one quantum of energy. What this is denoting is 0 quantum of energy, 1 quantum and 2 quantum, what you see is that particle 1 has 1 quantum of energy and all the others have 0 quantum of energy. Okay? So that's one distribution of energy. The total energy is 1. You can imagine that another distribution would be when particle 2 has 1 quantum of energy and all the other 3 have 0 quantum of energy and so on. Particle 3 has 1 quantum of energy and the others have 0, and the last one is this. And you'll see that this is it. Given that you have one total quantum of energy and four particles, there are only four possible ways in which you can distribute that energy. Okay? So these four possible ways are these four possible microstates. So this system, where there's one quantum of energy and four particles, has exactly four microstates. Okay? So in a system like this, very easy to calculate microstates. Now let's see why math becomes important. Okay? When you have small numbers to count, you don't need math, right? And you can do, or you need very preliminary math. And what math helps you do is help you, you know, count things which are difficult, among other things. So for this to kind of address this, to count microstates in chemical systems and in, you know, in general for any systems, you do need math. And math is absolutely indispensable. You will see that there are a lot of tools which are specifically developed to address this. I mean, the tools often were present in the math literature before, but they have been adapted to these chemical problems. Okay, so let's see where it is needed and what kind of math that you need. What kind of feature of this math app do you need? So the first thing that you need the math for is to determine the energy levels themselves. So we said the energy is context, right? To determine the energy levels themselves is what you need math for. So you need to solve this so-called Schrodinger equation to find those energy levels. That's the first thing you need math for. And the second thing is to do this counting. It was very easy to count when you had just one quantum and four particles, but you can imagine that if you have, you know, n quanta and n particles, it's going to get a little more complicated. You're not going to sit and count. You're going to try to use math there, right? So that is where math comes in. So to determine the energy levels, this part of chemistry is quantum chemistry, where we are, you know, solving this so-called Schrodinger equation, which many of you have seen. And the features of the math app that you will need are complex numbers, differential equations, linear algebra, you know, these kind of stuff are required to solve that part of the problem. And then there's this other part, which is this counting the number of microstates. This field is this so-called field of statistical thermodynamics. And here, you need probability and statistics, distributions, and, you know, that kind of stuff goes into understanding this. Now today, I'm going to focus more on this part, okay, just to keep it simple. Given that, you know, we have limited time, we'll just count the number of microstates. We'll assume that we already have the energy levels, but we'll count the microstates before and after a chemical change, okay, or a spontaneous change. Furthermore, you know, instead of doing the H2, this reaction first, H2 plus O2 reaction, which is, I'll tell you the complexities involved there, I'm going to take an even simpler spontaneous change, even simpler than that. And that simpler, very simple spontaneous change is something which all of you are familiar with, which is a hot body in contact with a cold body, right? Your whatever hot tea is kind of automatically, spontaneously cooling down. And if it is sitting on the table, this table is spontaneously getting warm, right? This process is something we take, and we take a very simplified version of this so that you can actually count microscales. So if you had a hot body and a cold body and you brought them in contact, it would take some time, but eventually, given enough time, there is no doubt that this will happen, that the, both the temperatures will become the same, and it will be a temperature in between the two, correct? It's a common experience, we have no problem understanding this. Now let us look at counting the microstates for this process. So here my A is my initial state, where you have hot body and cold body, and my B is my final state, where this state is at thermal equilibrium, nothing is changing anymore. Okay, no more change. Till then, there's something very dynamic happening. At the end of this, it has reached equilibrium. Nothing more has changed. So what I want to do is, I want to count the number of microstates in A and B. And what do you think should be the, what would you expect?
More microstates
in B than in A, correct? So this is just demonstrate how this idea can come out. It's the same amount of energy, but there will be more microstates in B as compared to A. Okay, so let's see how this happens. So again, to simplify it further, I'm going to say that each of these two bodies, the hot body and the cold body, each of them is made up of only four atoms, four particles. Okay, so that we can do the counting with actual numbers instead of doing N and M. I'm just going to do it with numbers. Sometimes it's just so much easier if you have concrete numbers for scientists. For mathematicians, probably just the opposite. But we'll do it with concrete numbers. We just take four particles, and we'll assume that the hot body has five quanta of energy, and the cold body has one quanta of energy. Okay, so just try to remember these numbers. The numbers are very simple. So, and also, you know, I'll put it graphically so that you just to write it in your head that you know what those numbers are. Five quanta in the hot, one in the cold. That's all you have to remember. Five in the hot, one in the cold. Right? And there are four particles. And at equilibrium, each will have three quanta. This is just a statement of the conservation of energy. Heat is nothing but energy. It will flow, it will equilibrate. Each will have exactly three quanta. Okay, understood the configuration of the system? Five in hot before, one in cold, both together, three in each. Now what we do is we count microstates. So, cold body first, because that's easy. You just had one quanta, remember? One in the cold body, five in the hot body, I said, okay? So one in the cold body, and there are four distinguishable particles. We already did this before. Remember, four particles, but let one more time. There's one quantum of energy, so you can put that one quantum in the first particle, or you can put it in the next particle or in the other particle. So you see that all these four different colors denote the four different particles. So you can put that one quantum in one of those different particles and zero in all the others. Okay, so you have exactly four microstates. You don't even need any more math to count this. Easy? Done? So this is how you count the microstate in the cold body. For the hot body, it gets a little more complicated. So for example, in the hot body, you have five quanta of energy. And see, these are some microstates I have drawn for you where how you can distribute the energy. The very first one on the left is where you have 5 quanta in one particle, in the yellow particle, and 0 in the other 3. In the second, you have 5 in the red particle and 0 in the other 3. In the third distribution, you have 4 in the yellow and 1 in the blue, 0 in the other 3, and so on and so on and so on. In principle, you could simply go on drawing or sketching out all of these, and if you are, you know, to do it precisely, you'll get the number correctly. But can we use some simple math to just get this number? That what is the number of these microstates? You want to distribute 5 quanta among 4 distinguishable particles. Okay? So to do that, this is the question. Now it is a mathematical question. How do you distribute 5 quanta, 5 indistinguishable things among 4 distinguishable objects? 4 distinguishable bins, if you want. Right? That is the mathematical question. And this is, I think, something which you need only 12th standard level mathematics to understand this. And we just use some representation here. Those 5 quanta of energy, which are identical, I represent with these 5 stars. And I'll put 3 partitions between them. Now look, if I put 3 partitions, I'll be able to separate this 5 quanta into 4 bins, into 4 parts. Correct? 3 partitions will give me 4 parts. So if I have 3 partitions and those 5, I can separate it into these 4 different particles. And this is one example of how those partitions can go. This partition, if I put it here, then I'll say the left of the first partition is corresponds to particle 1, which gets 1 quantum. Second, the next to the partition gets 2 quanta. Third particle gets 1 quantum. Fourth particle gets 4 quanta. See, there are 3 partitions, 5 stars, and this is nicely being able to tell me how many quanta are there in each particle. And to map this onto the actual energy diagram is like this. This means that the first particle had 1 quantum, red is 1. Second particle had 2 quanta, so that is 2. And so, so you have to always be able to map this back onto the picture of energy and quanta to the microscope, so that you can visualize it very clearly. Okay? And just if you want one more example, here is one more example of how you can arrange. The top part is the same, I've just changed the example here. Now the partitions are on the extreme left. What it means is there's a zero quanta on the first particle, because this is the part for the first particle. Between this is the part for the second particle. Between those two partitions is the part of the third particle, which is again zero, and on the right of the last partition is fourth particle, again zero. Correct? So this is corresponding to 5 quanta in particle 2 and all the others zero. Fair enough? So now you're getting where this, how we can generalize this formula and calculate the total number of these microstates. So in how many ways can 5 stars and 3 bars be arranged is the question. Right? And there are 8 objects in all. 8 factorials, but then 3 of them are identical and another 5 of them are identical. Right? So these 8 permutations, you have to remove the repeats because it will be because of this identical 5 and identical 3. So that would be the total number of microstates in this case. Right? I hope all of you will see that. So that's 56 microstates in the hot body initially. All this I was doing for calculating microstates in the hot body. And now, if I go, so these are the microstates in the hot body. Now, at thermal equilibrium, what has happened is each of those bodies are having 3 quanta of energy. Right? Initially, 5 in one and 1 in the other. After equilibrium, 3 in each. Right? So, at thermal equilibrium, there are 3 stars, but the same number of particles in each object. Right? So, there will be 3 bars, and then it is 6 factorial now, divided by 3 factorial, divided by 3 factorial. 3 for the identical bars, 3 for the identical stars. So you have 20 different microstates. Okay? So then, now you just want to go and look back at before and after. Before there were 2 objects, hot and cold. What was the total number of microstates there? 56, which was there in the hot, times 4 that was there in the cold. 224 microstates initially. Later, 20 in each. Right? So 20 times 20. 400. Right, so this is it. Do you see what has happened? It's the same amount of energy that is there on the left hand side and the right hand side. But the number of ways in which they can be distributed are many, many more in on the right hand side. And that is the reason why this system, why nature is wanting to move in that direction. Just because there's more accessible microstate. And this then brings up to, I didn't even talk about this word entropy, which you know, you don't even need to talk about it. If you're going to count these microstates, that's it. But just to help you connect to something you might study and you might come across, is this word entropy. So entropy is nothing but it is defined as this quantity S, which is a constant times logarithm, natural log of the number of microstates. Right? So it's a measure of the distribution, it's a measure of how energy is distributed. Right? And the second law of thermodynamics, many of you might have seen, is that in any spontaneous change, energy of the entropy of the universe increases. What does that mean? During any spontaneous change, the total energy of the universe is remaining what it is, it's constant. But that energy is redistributing. In particular, it's moving from a clumped up state to a spread out state. The universe is spreading out in general. Right? Anytime you're burning a fossil fuel, the energy was more clumped up there, and after it has burned, it has become more spread out. And that is determining the direction of change. So, during the spontaneous heat transfer that we studied, a very simplified spontaneous change, the obvious thing is the number of microstates increased. In a more qualitative manner, we could say energy which was clumped up has now become more spread out. Or entropy of the final state, if you want to use the word entropy, then the entropy of the final state, B, is greater than the entropy of the initial state, A. Okay, so now let's come back to the reaction we started with. This is much harder. Actually, it's a lot more harder. So this one was just a demonstration that in any spontaneous change, because the states were the same before and after, right? And in both the objects, the states were the same. This, as you can imagine, is complicated because H2 is different from O2 is different from H2O. But the basic idea, the concept is pretty much the same. The mathematics and so the part which gets harder is what, if you can imagine, would be what? it is calculating those quantized energy levels. Calculating those quantized energy levels will be harder for this one. But once you have those quantized energy levels, it is again just probability and combinatorics, no, nothing else. It's exactly what you did before, okay? And little more involved, the microstates. But again, you will find, and this can be done, it's not very hard. It is just that, you know, I can't do it in 20 minutes here, but we do, we can, you know, routinely, you know, calculate this. And it turns out that there will be more microstates in the final state than the initial state. So energy was, again, I say, clumped up. So that's how to think about it. Anytime you see any change happening, and there's change happening all the time, right? There's little sounds coming here and there. You're moving, you're talking, all of the, anytime a change is happening, energy is going up from a clumped up state to a more spread out state. That's the only thing that is happening, which is driving this change. And here, in this particular case, what happened? Energy was clumped up in this H2 and O2. And when the reaction happened, when the change happened, now that energy has spread out, in particularly where? All the heat that was generated in heating all the air around. That's the reason why fuels are used, right? Because that clumped up energy is now being used, that heat is now being used for something. So that is what drove this change. This, and it created the sound. The sound also eventually was just motion of the air, right? And it heated the air. Okay, so that's my conclusion. So the driving force for a spontaneous change is that the system will move to places where there are more options. It's as simple as that. If there are more options, you will take it. It's just that. That's the rule. So nature prefers to have more options, right? And this is like so natural to many of us that, you know, you don't have to take it as a rule. It is, you know, we feel very connected with nature with this statement. Although, you know, now, you know, there are studies which say actually too many options actually are not so good. But this empirically works fine. So that's it. And the mathematics is really needed. It's very key to understanding chemical reactivity, because you need the mathematics first to calculate the energy states, which is this field of quantum chemistry. And then you need to count the number of options, which is this field of statistical thermodynamics. Okay? So yeah, with that I'll just stop, and I just want to thank some people, because this that heat diffusion video that I took and the numbers that I took are exactly from an MIT OpenCourseWare video. Okay, so I took it right from there, and you know the numbers are simple, and you know they've just done it right. So I just took it straight from there. And of course I want to thank Arnab, who is my teacher in a lot of these things. We end up discussing quite a lot. He's somewhere here, and you know, so that's great fun talking about all this. Sopan helped us fill those hydrogen balloons, because as theoreticians, we don't even know how to fill a hydrogen balloon correctly and not blow it up before bringing it here. So thanks Sopan for that. And the IISER Media Center for running that video backwards for us, so that, you know, you could see that, you know, that it really is an improbable process. So thank you, and I can take questions.